My next guest was one of the big winners a couple weeks ago, getting that win over Brandon Moreno as an underdog. He came through. It is Brandon Royval back here on the program. Brandon, how are you?
I'm doing good. Did you see something about, like, somebody posted it, and it was like, out of my last 16 fights, 14 of them I was the underdog in?
I haven't seen that, but that wouldn't surprise me. I know you've been counted out a lot, Brandon, and you've been coming through. So,
I think the only underdog I haven't been in the UFC was Matt Schnell.
Interesting. Do you like that, though? I mean, it must feel sort of, I'm sure you would like to get the respect from people, but also, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of people as well who are probably, you know, betting on you, and then now they owe you a steak dinner, right?
Yeah. I have a big fat fuck you on my, on my like a chip on my shoulder at all times. So, I feel like I kind of learned to live with that, and that's kind of like been me for a minute. So I guess it's just I'm used to it. So it's not that I necessarily like it. It's just that I'm like, whatever, fuck you guys. I'm going to show you guys wrong again. And
for sure. Like, well, you're getting
– with certain fighters too, it's like if you're in my gym and you're in the know, like some of these fights I'm like, why are you guys betting against me on this? This is crazy. So and then it also has me second guess myself sometimes where I'm like, maybe I'm the ignorant one. Like maybe I don't know what the fuck's going on. So.
Yeah. Well, anyways, it's great to see. And you're getting a lot of attention, Brandon. We were sort of talking off air a bit. I know you did Quentin Jackson's podcast, the Jackson podcast, did the MMA hour yesterday. I feel like you got more attention for this win than you did even leading up to your title fight. What's that been like over the last week and a bit where a lot of people are, you know, wanting to talk to you?
Yeah. I've been actually chilling pretty low for the most part. I signed a contract that I wasn't going to do any podcast till the Jackson podcast. And that came out on like a Thursday. So from there, it was like, I didn't do that much media.
Mm-hmm. Well, I just mean like Quentin Jackson's podcast is pretty big. MMA Hour is pretty big. Like that must feel cool that you're getting this recognition now after, you know, being in the UFC for as long as you have, right?
Yeah, for sure. And it's like, that's the risk that you take when I was fighting Brandon Moreno. It's just like, I knew that there's a lot of like risky stuff, taking a short notice fight in a different country and all that other stuff. But it's just like, I'm fighting the most popular guy in my division, and that's what I'm looking to do, you know?
Yeah, no, for sure. Let's talk quickly about the fight. I know you kind of covered most of it yesterday with your interview with Ariel, but I was curious, when it went to the scorecards, how confident were you? Because we've had some bad decisions recently, and you never really know what the judges.
I was super confident, but after the fight ended, I was just going to make sure all the judges know that I thought I won that shit. And like, I was walking around, I'm like, that's me. That was fucking me all day. And, Yeah. So I did that like Nick Diaz, BJ Penn, where it's like, I won that shit.
Yeah.
I had that in my head a little bit too. I wasn't thinking of that, but when I went back and like looked at myself or like reflected, I was like, damn, I kind of just stole that Nick Diaz thing and just kind of like it. But in my head, it was just like, I won that shit. If you guys are going to rip me off a decision, I want you guys to know that I know that's bullshit, like in my head. So that's what I was thinking in my head. And then also it was just like one of those things too, is like, the crowd knew I won that too. Like the crowd wasn't like, it wasn't like I was getting booed when the decision was read. It wasn't like you hear these decisions where it's like not even someone's home country and they boo so loud and you're like, oh, that was a robbery for sure. And things are gonna get awkward. But it wasn't that. Like it wasn't, the crowd booed for like 2 seconds, but it was just like, they're like, yeah, well, for sure.
Yeah, no, I agree. I don't know if you know this, but there's a website called MMA Decisions where the media can actually put their scorecards in for the fight. So I went back and looked at that. 13 media members scored the fight for you. Only 5 scored it for Brandon. Just your reaction to hearing that, because I'm sure you didn't know that.
Somebody sent me that yesterday, but like I said, it's more validation. There's validation too, where it's like Dana White was like, yeah, I scored the fight for Brandon, and everybody I was with scored the fight for Royval. I always forget that we have the same name.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, Royval. Yeah, we'll stick with that so we don't confuse people. So
that was the validation I needed a little bit too, is just like, yo, Dana got the fight scored for me, and then all of his whole entire crew has that fight scored for me, which is like more validation on top of that.
Yeah, no, it's well deserved. And again, huge win. You're the main event. You're fighting this guy technically in his backyard. And the guy being Brandon Moreno, no disrespect. How did you celebrate after the win? I was curious about that. I know you had your girl with you. You had obviously your team around you. What was it like after the fight?
I just went home. I went home, ate a bunch of food. I went home and just kind of just relaxed my girl for like a good 5 days of just eating food, chilling, and just doing a whole lot of nothing, you know, and a lot of ice baths, a lot of recovery, a lot of just relaxing. So I didn't do anything major. I'll probably try to do something this weekend or something.
Are you checking your phone at all? Or are you just kind of like, I'm turning everything off. I want to spend time like enjoying like all this. Cause I know it's a lot going into camps, right? And you know, a lot of stuff can kind of pull you in different directions, but I'm sure you're just like, I just want to enjoy this. Right.
I feel like, it's always just, you always realize this after losses too. It's just like, who's there for you? Who's not there for you? And, who's the more important people in your life when you lose a fight? And after I lost that title fight, man, it's just like, you kind of realize who quickly is like, who's there when there's a belt on the line and who's there when the belt's off the line. And I really just kept to myself this whole, like after this win, it just, I stood off social media a little bit, posted like a couple of pictures, but
kind of kept it low.
Yeah, sure. Kept it low, bro. I kept it real low.
Wanted to talk quickly about this because I know you mentioned it a bit yesterday and obviously you had the tweets about it too. Muhammad Mokaev, I know you said you weren't really impressed with his performance. What specifically about the fight were you not impressed with? Was it anything in particular or was it just his overall performance?
I just think the overall tactic is just like, it's not my style, you know what I'm saying? Like his style and my style are very much not the same. So I guess when I watch his fight, it's just, I'm just not a fan, I guess is one way to say it. Like when I watch Pantoja, it's like, I'm a fan. Like I like watching that dude fight. Like I like watching the fight. Brandon Moreno, I'm a fan. Kai Car France, I'm a fan. Like there's dudes where you're like, dang, I like watching him fight. And it's like in your division, out of your division, whatever it is, but there's certain people where you're like, I wouldn't tune into it if I didn't have to.
I know after the fight, he posted, like, I guess he had staph infection and all this different stuff. There's sort of two schools of thought on that, right? There's a school of thought of like, hey, we as the audience want to know if you had something going into the fight, right? Like people want to get the full context. But then there's the other side being like, you're kind of making excuses. Where do you fall on that as a fighter? Just in general, I'm not even talking about him specifically. Do you think fighters should reveal things after the fight? Or do you think they should just keep it to themselves and maybe let the coach say it or something so it doesn't look like it's coming directly from them?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I guess I go both ways on that, but it's like, I feel like every single fighter has something, you know, like there's always something that you're dealing with. And that's like really just the sad part about the sport is just like, what do you say? He has staph or stomach issues or something like that.
Something with his knee. And then I know there was another thing about, I think it was something where I remember him tweeting about the fact that like he had to go to like a McDonald's cause he couldn't go up his stairs or something. So like just to go to the bathroom, he mentioned something about that, like during camp, I guess.
Oh yeah. See, I didn't read it. Like I wasn't reading any of his like stuff, yeah. But, you deal with a lot as a fighter, man. This sport sucks. Cutting weight sucks, fucking coming back. And like, you have to be really careful on how you rehydrate and do all that. Like, cause if you go and just eat too much food, you're going to get yourself sick. You're going to get like, there's a lot of bad things that could come along with it. And I'm not saying that's what happened with him. Cause I really have no clue, what his case is or his scenario is.
Yeah.
But, even getting to a fight is insane. And it's like, I was thinking that with just like my fight alone is just like, I hurt myself throwing a kick at Brandon Moreno. And it's like, forget getting kicked. Throwing kicks will damage your body. Like throwing punches will damage your body. Like anything you do, you got to think about it. You're throwing bones and you're throwing caution to the wind and all this other stuff. That shit will damage your body. And it's like, you're throwing bones on bones. And it's like, this is such a dumb sport when you think about it, of like your bill of health and all that other stuff is like, what you're doing is damaging your body are damaging someone else's body with your body. And it's like, man, it's kind of crazy half of us even make it to these fights, to be real, to be completely honest. And it's like to have two fights in 2 months. And if I get this next fight, having three fights in like a span of 6 months or 4 months or however long it is, it's like, that's a whole lot of Hail Marys of just like hoping I make it to the next camp and hopefully nothing went wrong. And that's assuming if something doesn't go wrong, and like there's always something that goes wrong in these fights. So it's just kind of it's a gamble what we do for sure.
No, well said. And I think that's, you know, that's important as well, where, you know, I think fans got to have a little bit more empathy, you know, for fighters and what they go through in a camp. Like it's not just like they had a bad night. There could be, you know, things going in and all this stuff too. So I think you articulated it well. Just last thing on that fight, because I don't know if I got your official opinion. Who did you think won that fight between Mokaev and Perez? Because it was close. A couple of those rounds, especially 2 and 3, I think were very close. How did you score it after watching the fight?
I scored it for Mokaev. I wasn't going to say that on Twitter, to be real. Like, I wasn't saying, because it's like too close, but it's just like, I thought Alex Perez could have landed like more, like if he would have landed a little bit more punches when he was defending those takedowns, I think he would have won the fight easily. It's just one of those, like, I feel like he was just so precautious on the takedowns that it looked like he was just more defending than what he should have been. You know what I'm saying? Like it's just more, it turned into more of a defensive thing where if he was on the opposite side of things and was like defending and then throwing a couple punches in the process of that, then it changes things, right? But
No,
I feel like he did a lot more defending than he could have been. You know, I think if he would have defended, hit him a couple times, then it would have been a clear Alex 2-2 and 3. But the third one was iffy, and then I think you can just give it to Makai based off of that slam.
Okay, there we go. Okay, let's move along. UFC 301. I know you said you're good to go if that's an option of fighting Pantoja and all that. I guess my question would be, what would be different about the rematch, or I guess your third fight? I guess you guys have fought a couple times. What would be different about this fight than say the fight before?
I'm just working on wrestling defense, getting up. You could see it a little bit in that Brandon Moreno fight of just like. I'm not getting taken down easily. Like I think he got one takedown on me, and I got right back up. I almost submitted him, and then I got right back up. So it's just one of those like, and I've been good at that. I've been okay at that. I just didn't think that was a tactic I was gonna have to use with Pantoja necessarily of just like defending wrestling all the time. And I was mainly just so concerned about the back take that I didn't take too much. I wasn't really myself in there, and that's kind of like I guess like the lame excuse that I'm going with, which is like, you know, but that being said, you watch the Moreno fight is like, I fixed a lot of, I made a lot of adjustments really quick. And the adjustments I need to beat Pantoja aren't major. They're nothing crazy. I can make small adjustments along the way and beat him. And I really do believe that.
And how much too, like, are you riding off this last win? Like, you know, not many people have beaten Brandon Moreno since he's come back to the UFC. So that's got to be something that I would imagine just from a mental standpoint as well, that would, you know, it's confidence, like a lot of it is mental, right? So going into a fight like Pantoja, you just beat a guy that like no one's been able to beat really since he's come back to the UFC. So how much are you sort of feeding off that too?
A little bit, man. I guess I'm gonna give much thought. It's just, I'm already on to the next thing. I feel like beating Brandon Moreno, the biggest part of it was just getting to the next spot and trying to get this title shot. So I guess the time for celebration isn't even yet right now. It's just, we'll see what happens with this title shot. If I can get it, then we're going right back to work. And it's just like, you know, I'm not going to rest on my laurels. And mainly I just want to get right back at it, you know, and I kind of just want to, I want that belt wrapped around my waist this year for sure. So it's whatever I can do to get there is ideal, you know? And it's like, if that's fighting one more person and then I'll go do that. But if it's getting Pantoja in that Brazil card, then I'll be ready. I'll be ready. And I know I can beat him.
So playing a little kind of hypothetical here, if it's not you next for the title, if you were the UFC matchmaker, who would you give the title shot to? If for some reason they're like, hey, the fight's too soon because you guys had fought at 296 and they went with someone else, who do you think is the most deserving? Because this is the big question, Brandon, because it's like, who really is out there that stands out? Because, I mean, you could nitpick at all of them as far as who's more deserving than you, right?
Yeah, I don't really know who else they would give it to, I guess. Is like,
well, I'll throw a couple names out and then we can obviously like go through each one. And I'm not trying to talk smack about these guys, but I just think it's important to talk about the optics. You got Manel Kopp. I've seen a lot of people mention him, but he missed weight in his last fight, right? And there was that issue about
and
him.
And he missed weight by like 4.5 pounds, right? Or something like kind of heavy, right?
Yeah.
So, and then it's like 125 sucks to make. Like the 1 pound sucks. Like I'll be real. Like I've been making championship weight this whole last year, and that last pound is hard. Then Manel Kopp, you get Albazi, who, you know, maybe he beat Kai Car France, maybe he didn't. It just depends on how you scored that. But that being said, is like his only real win over anyone in the top 10 is very controversial. Mm-hmm. You got Makayev, who's coming off of a win off of Alex Perez, and it's like, maybe that's it, but it's just, other than that, it's like, I don't really know who else would get it, you know? Like, I don't know who's deserving, and I don't know. I really don't know, honestly. The UFC, I knew beating Moreno, I put the UFC in a fucked up position, and I guess that was kind of my goal anyways, just spoil everybody's party and fucking make their job hard.
And just so you know, again, referencing MMA decisions, and this isn't the be-all, end-all, but that Amir Albazi, Kai Kara-France fight, I'm just looking at it now, 19 media members scored the fight for Kai Kara-France, 2 media members scored it for Albazi. So I don't think you're alone on that fight being, maybe that could have gone the other way with Amir Albazi. And the other thing is he healthy? That was the whole issue, right? Like, he was supposed to fight Moreno, you stepped in, so is he even going to be ready for 301? I think that's the other issue with Amir Albazi, right?
Yeah, exactly. So we can almost scratch him off the list. Manel Cape, I think he's been super impressive in his last wins. I don't know if he's even beat anybody in the top five or anything yet, but I feel like he's been super impressive in his last wins. But then you go and miss weight, and I think he's missed weight multiple times as far as like being a flyweight, at least two times, right? And doesn't necessarily look good for the next title shot. And then who else would be right after?
I think that's pretty much it. Like, I think honestly, those are all the names. Let's just say they go with Mokaev. Would you be open to a Manel Cop fight? I think that would be kind of a fun matchup for you two because you guys haven't fought each other.
Yeah, I think he's currently signed to a fight.
Oh, is he?
Yeah,
Okay, gotcha.
I don't want to be the breaking
No,
news
no,
on
no, no,
that.
no, no, no worries. No, listen, Nate, we're
Pretty
getting no one
positive.
in trouble here. It's not your management, right? So don't have to worry about it.
He's signed to a fight already.
Well, I
I
was going
like
to
the
ask you too, if you were to fight him,
outlaw.
I was just going to quickly mention, if you were to fight him, would you not be a bit worried or have some sort of thing in the contract being like, if he misses weight, because that like it is a thing with him, right?
I mean, I guess I don't give a shit about that. Like,
Okay.
and
No, I was
but I
curious.
thought it was a smart. I thought it was like I would have been mad at whoever Mateus Nicolai's coach if they would have let him fight that, because it's like Mateus Nicolai already has a win over him. You're taking a fight, and that's like 4.5 pounds. Like, that's a lot, you know. That's at a certain point, that's kind of a lot of fucking money. That's a big advantage. And there's like a statistic in the UFC of like guys that miss weight, how often they win, and it's usually like the guys that miss weight usually win the fights. Like, it's like a weird statistic that it's like, but it's like you gotta imagine how much he's going back into the fight weighing, you know. If he's having a hard time making weight, then he's probably coming to that fight weighing almost 150 pounds, 147, something like that. And it's like that weight adds up, man. The cutting weight's hard, and it's like there's a lot
It's
that
half the
plays
fight,
into
right? Like just making the weight. It's a whole process, right? For a lot of you guys. So I understand. By the way, I
it. And
interrupted you before I was talking about Cop and all that. What were you going to say? You were saying something about Cop and the fact that he's got a fight booked or something? I forget.
Yeah, just that he has a fight booked already. I think Albazi would be the next smart fight for me, because I think he's ranked number two or three, and he's the only guy that I don't have a win over in the top five. Other than that, I have a win over everybody in the top five of the division. So it's like, I don't know who else I'd fight either. It's like I beat Kai, I beat Mateus Nicolai, I beat Moreno. All I have is Albazi, really. And then at that point, it's just like maybe a title shot after that. But it's like I'll fight Albazi for sure. And then just whoever, like I'll put my number against any of these guys. I'll put the number one ranking against any of these fighters, and just to go fulfill what I want to do is just be the champion of the world one of these days. And it's like I feel like I already did it on the way up to being the number one ranked. Is I was clearing out everybody behind me. There was a moment in time where I was ranked number six. I couldn't break the top five, and I would beat number seven three times in a row. And then all of a sudden, they'd give me the next number seven, and it's like, damn, bro, what do I gotta do? You know, it was that until they gave me a title shot. So I
No, I
was just
agree.
fighting number seven, number seven, number seven, and it's like I could do this over and over, but I'm just clearing division behind me. Like, I want to clear it out in front of me too, you know.
Just looking at a potential fight with Albazi, stylistically, how do you think like your style matches up against his?
I think it's someone that I could just take the fight wherever, really. I think Albazi is very good everywhere. I think he, when I watch him, he doesn't take much risk and he doesn't make much mistakes. So a guy like that will be hard to fight for sure. Because a person like me, I'm super impatient and I'll make a ton of mistakes trying to make him make a mistake. But I also just think like I'm a hard matchup for him too, because I'm going to be in his face the whole entire fight. I'm not going to let him take a break. I'm not going to let him chill and then, you know, win on these points matches. I'm going to make him work. And it's like, that's gonna force mistakes, and I think I can capitalize off that.
Any update from your management? Are they going to talk to the UFC? What have you heard from that end of things? Because they're obviously the ones trying to, get you your next fight.
Yeah, I'm trying to stay on them. They're the ones that told me to do like just stay a little more active on social media and all that stuff, which is I'm not really that good at, so I need to work on all
I
that
think you've
stuff.
done a good job. You got everyone's attention on Saturday with those tweets. So, I mean, I think more people are talking about that than the fight itself, right? So.
Yeah, I don't think. Never mind.
Anyways, it's all good. Okay, we're gonna end on some fun questions that have nothing to do with MMA because we always talk about fights and we've done I don't know how many interviews, but figure we'll go with some rapid fire fun questions here, a bit different than last time. Brandon Royval, your favorite athlete outside of combat sports?
Michael Jordan.
What's your favorite movie?
My favorite movie. Oh man. My favorite movie. That's a good question. Let me think. I like Fight Club, which is like so corny. I like Fight Club. Yeah, I'll just go with that, Fight
No,
Club.
it's a great, excellent choice. What's your favorite TV show?
My favorite TV show? Probably South Park. I haven't watched it in a long time, but South Park.
Favorite cheat meal?
Tacos.
Favorite comedian?
My favorite comedian. Dang. I like Ralphie Barbosa.
Okay. Favorite travel destination?
I mean, I haven't traveled much, but I want to go to Japan, but I guess as far as favorite, I've only been to Mexico, really. So I guess Mexico.
What's your favorite animal?
Monkeys.
What's your hidden talent that we don't know about?
A hidden talent that you guys don't know
Like, what's
about.
something you're good at that maybe we didn't know you're good at?
Oh, I could ice skate. I could ice skate really well.
I'll put that to the test one of these days. What's your biggest biggest pet peeve? What's something that really annoys you? Like, some people have said, I'll give you some examples. Like, people have said, like, bad drivers, or like they hate doing laundry or doing the dishes, or I don't know, stuff like that. Anything like that come to mind? Like, day-to-day stuff that annoys you or anything?
I hate being asked like a bunch of rhetorical questions. I feel like that's something that like I don't like people just asking questions just to like have conversations or whatever. I'm just like, just chill the moment of silence sometimes, you know?
Fair enough. Hopefully, I haven't done any of those here today in this
No,
interview. It's all good.
sorry, sorry.
No, it's all
It
good. Two quick questions. First one, what do you got planned the rest of the week? You mentioned you're going to kind of take it easy and enjoy things. You got anything planned?
I'll probably end up in Vegas sometime. I try to get tickets to that the UFC Miami. That'd be cool, but just watch the fights.
Okay. So there you go. And any plans? It looks like the Avalanche are going to make the playoffs like they usually do. Any plans to go to any games soon? I know you haven't been too much on the hockey scene. I'm still waiting for, and maybe I'll ask you this every interview. When are you going to get like recognized at an Avs game? Like, how come they can't bring you on? Like, they've done that with other fighters. I know Sterling and Brian Kelleher got at the Islanders game. How come you haven't got any recognition at the Avs game? You got to get in your management for that.
That's a good point, man. I know the Rockies have reached out to me, but as far as like anybody else, I haven't really got any recognition from that. So it'd be cool to go like throw like a first pitch or something like that, but to be at the Avs game would be super sweet.
Cool. All right, Brandon, appreciate the time. I got to get out of here. I got my next interview, but anything you want to plug before you get out of here, I'll give you the last word.
Yeah, EAP Glass, man, thank you guys for everything you do, and yeah, I guess that's it. Thank you very much for your time.